obviously not like we did, it says in Kohelet, loylach ochom lechem. Just because you're smart does not mean that you make a lot of money. As a matter of fact, most of the time it's the stupid people who make the money. That think outside the box. Smart people always think inside the box. It has to be according to the rules and the regulations, etc., etc. And therefore they restrict themselves. They tie themselves down. Whereas the not so smart person, he takes risk. He doesn't think about it. And guess what? He pressed the right button. So it's not all the way the world appears to us. So therefore, the word efficiency is a bit of a very ambiguous word. Of course, when you talk about talking or going by car or taking a bus or taking an airplane, of course we know what's what. So then it's a question of, for as long as, but if you, for example, let's put it this way. If you know that the planes would be on a level of pre-historic times, Wright Brothers times, etc., etc., and it's a danger to use these planes, the safety is far from guaranteed, it's still more efficient. It's still much more efficient. But is it worth the risk? What you may lose there may boomerang. So that's again where you bring in other factors that come into play that you have to consider. And there where a person has a value system of religion or other ethical value system, you would take that into consideration as well. Cheating is much more efficient. Much more efficient. So you can argue the same thing. So what's wrong with cheating? Well, it's illegal. Illegal, so that's dealing with the government. So if it's merely a legal matter, so if I can get away with it, that's okay. It's not a moral matter. Law is not morality. Law is simply law. This is allowed by law, this is not allowed by the law. This, if you've obeyed the law, you're not a moral person. You're a sociable person, you're within society, you're an efficient person, but it has nothing to do with morality, right and wrong and good and bad. So therefore, if I can get away with it, by all means, I'll do it. It's more efficient. And yet, I would assume that you would argue, no. Cheating becomes kind of counterproductive because it corrupts the rest of society. If everybody cheats, then everybody loses. So therefore, that's how we pass most laws. What is to the benefit, the greater benefit of the greater number of people in society. That's the foundation of so-called democracy.
Isn't that moral? Isn't that ethical?
That has nothing to do with morality. No, nothing to do with ethical morality at all. It has to do with practical, not with moral. It's practical, but not moral.
Oh, but moral can always be cheap. Morals can always, you said yourself, moral can always be twisted. So technically, morals don't always work either. That's why you have to have it.
There is no such thing as morality outside religious context. Morality needs some kind of an absolute standard to determine this is right, this is wrong, this is good, this is evil. Where do you get these standards from? What is the foundation for them? I need an absolute standard for absolute definitions. The only thing that I can think of that is absolute is God. Outside God is nothing absolute. Therefore, philosophers have been struggling with ethics for 2,500 years, trying to find ethical norms and ethical standards outside of religion. They've written, I don't know, countless books in every generation, literally. Go to any university, every generation, new books are written on it. Because all the old books have been refuted. Every argument that has been brought is shown to have a hole in it, which does not convince that this makes it an absolute standard. It all becomes kind of what you call today situational ethics, relative ethics. Relative means relative to the time, relative to the situation, relative to the conditions. As the conditions change, so will these things change. 50 years ago, abortion was a capital offense. 50 years ago, a homosexual act was a capital offense. Today, the government says you can get married. Abortion is not just we allow it, it's even abortion on demand. We're not even talking about where there's a need. Abortion on demand, a woman decides, I changed my mind. And not just change the mind, she can change her mind up to the 9th month. Even in the 9th month, she can change her mind. I want to abort it. I decided not to have it.
Partial birth is illegal.
Huh? In some states, not all. No, they want to pass a law. They want to pass a law. No, it's not a federal law yet. They want to pass it. They want to pass it here in Congress. And they say in many countries it isn't. Which means that again, so we are talking here now about things which were capital offenses, the worst that you can imagine. And today, run of the mill, but nothing wrong with it. So as people's minds, people's attitudes change, the law changes. The law simply reflects the will of the people. But the will of the people, you have Nazi Germany, it's the will of the people.
So
Hitler was voted into power with a vast majority, democratically. And that was the will of the majority of the Germans. Does that make it all? In Russia, the Bolshevik Revolution, will of the people. For that matter, look at Gaza, look at all that, will of the people.
So a lot of times, I'm able to say, a lot of times,
huh?
The Jews should rule the world, then, are you saying?
Why should the Jews rule the world?
If not the will of the people, then what should it be based on? Well, I'm saying bad things can happen, but it's the best we can do, no?
The best we can do, that is what this law is trying to do. Law is trying to do the best that we can do in the context that we are not going to offend too many people, so therefore we go by democratic ways. What is the majority? Majority.
So what would be your alternative to the will of the people to prevent things like the Bolshevik Revolution in Nazi Germany?
You can't have it both ways. If you want to,
right.
If you want to take it in terms of democracy, you have to let them do whatever they want to do.
Why were the people punished before the mob then? They didn't have power, they didn't have religion or anything yet. Why?
First of all, they did. They had the Noahide code.
From who?
The Shemites from God. That was given already to Adam.
The people never heard it themselves. Like
so Oh, I'm not talking about Sinai. We're talking about here. It was God speaking to Adam, who was the only person at the time, who then passed it on, the same as in our generations. We passed it on to his children. For that matter, there were prophets even amongst the later ones that God spoke to during the 10 generations between Adam and Noah, and they were forewarned and they were told, but they shrugged their shoulders, because if you want to bring in all kinds of self-rationalizations, which every one of us does, whenever we really want to do something and we know we shouldn't really be doing it, you're bent over backwards to find every excuse under the sun why your case is different, and in your case it should be okay. If you do it, you go to hell. But for me, it's okay, because my conditions and my circumstances are different. I have every excuse for myself. And that's how people then rationalize whatever they do, for better or for worse. So therefore, the Dohar Mabul definitely corrupted the only thing that was given to Noach later on, is Eva Minachai, not to tear a limb from a living animal. But all the other six laws have been given already before.
Testimony for one person.
Huh?
Testimony.
Yeah, with all respect, it's not like Christianity.
Testimony from the one person who lived through half of these generations, the direct contact with them, their own ancestor, who passed it on, and we verified by some of his eineklach that God spoke to as well.
How's that different than Christianity? It's one person who was passed on by a few disciples. I mean, that's how it sounds.
It was not just one person, it was all of humanity.
That's a good point.
That's true. But he was given the right to spread whatever.
Verified later on through his own son that, yes, God spoke to me also. Shays, God spoke to him as well. So this was verified again, this tradition, passed on. So if you can't...
You could have put another person in the second room and then they know...
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. He was just the person, that, like you said, there's three rooms. He was just, Adam was the first room.
No, there was no other person. There was no other claim.
It's not Shays.
Huh?
Shays.
That God verified it with Shays. The same thing that he told to Adam.
Did he contradict him?
The same thing. And then later Chanoich, Mesushelach, all these, they're all the goddess prophets, suppose. So this was verified, and then you have the original conveyor of this message, who lived right with them. You're not going to believe your own grandfather. Why would he lie to you? What would he gain by that? Especially since it was restrictions. These six laws are basically five prohibitions and only one law. So why would he want to restrict himself? He could make it more convenient and more easy for himself as well. Okay, next question.
Wait, you mentioned the will of the people. In fact, even the Bolshevik Revolution or Nazi Germany, these people, when they voted in, or say it was the will of the people, they had no idea. Most of those catastrophes, if you want to call them that, or the Holocaust, was done by, it's not exactly the majority of the people.
I'm sorry.
I mean, listen, the Bolshevik Revolution, 50 million people...
I got news for you, my friend. The Holocaust did not start in 1940.
Or 1933, or when...
No. Holocaust started in 1936. Not with Jews. Kristallnacht was only in 1938. The whole idea, the underlying idea of Holocaust started as early as 1936, and not by the grubber masses, the plebeians, the coot farmers and what have you. It was started and written up in journals by professors, doctors, medical practitioners, professors at universities, starting with, first of all, killing, gassing. Gassing started then already. Gassing the criminally insane. That's the first ones. Then those who the repeat offenders. Then the incurable insane. It was a whole progression. In Germany this was done. And they saw the gas trucks traveled to the insane asylums and to the jails through the cities, and people would point with their fingers, oh, they're going to get rid of some more of them. This was public knowledge. Not only public knowledge, it was written up in medical journals.
Still available?
Yes, still available. Still available.
Let's go.
Now, never mind eugenics. You're talking here about getting rid of undesirable human beings. Once you have established a principle that certain people are subhuman, are not human,
yeah, I mean,
but subhuman.
The Aryan race was that idea, but you don't...
Not just Aryan race, we're not talking about Aryan race. Aryan race, you can talk about the blacks and the Jews and the gypsies and things like that. You're talking here subhuman, that you do not live up to the quality of human beings. So then it's a slippery slope. Then it was a small step to move to the Jews. But the shocking thing is how nobody said a word. If this would be something, some kind of a secret experiment, I can understand. But written up in journals in 1937, 1938, explaining the experiments that it did, and how to get rid of it, and then the fast way, the humane way, yeah, the special gas trucks before the body, big cyclone gases
in this conflict.
So therefore, don't tell me that they did not know. This was pretty much public knowledge.
They weren't public.
It was public knowledge, even by the public, the population of Germany, that people knew that when they saw these trucks, what these trucks are traveling through the cities. This is all documented. This is not something new. This is not an invention from later on. And the shock comes out when you think back, how people simply shrugged their shoulders. You know, the American thing. Mind your own business. And it's. It's an independent country, the same as Iran schemes today. Hey, mind your own business. What we do in our country, you develop your nuclear power, and let us develop our nuclear power. You have your bombs, so let us make our bombs. What's the difference? Etc., etc. We are, after all, an independent nation, the same as you are. So who are you to tell me what to do and what not to do? And that becomes then, if we came to an invention of the United Nations, which is just a joke, seemingly to establish some kind of international law and international principles of human proper conduct, etc., etc. But you know and I know this doesn't work. Next.
All right, so back to this kid grows up in this house, he turns 13 to 20, he's thinking about God, does he have the answers? And he finds himself intellectually incapable.
Are you making up these questions yourself now as you go along?
No,
or these are
this
okay,
is
okay.
I'm trying to get it.
Okay.
He finds himself intellectually incapable.
The reason I'm asking you is, seems I want to give a chance for all these questions to be answered.
Right.
We don't overrun.
No, yeah. So he finds it incapable of believing. Should he continue going with the routine, or is it just a waste of time for him, since he doesn't feel his actions?
If it's a question of not feeling, of not understanding, then of course I would say yes, he should continue doing it. The same as the kid does not understand or feel the value or the purpose of medicine that he takes. Or for that matter, how this medicine works. There isn't a doctor on earth who can explain to me even how an aspirin works. All the doctor can tell me, if you have this or that condition, take this or that medication, these or those chemicals, and they have this and that effect. Why they have this effect? No one knows. We don't even know how the digestive system works. I can describe you how the digestive system works, but I haven't got a clue how the body is able to separate the nutritious part and discard the waste and so forth. How does the body know exactly what to do with what and that? Or even when we talk about nutritious food, right? We know that by the effects. We do not know that by the cause. We know that by the effects. But we know that from certain chemicals, certain medical treatments, certain foods, nutrients, vitamins, whatever it is, that they have certain effects upon the body. So therefore, all we have here is a descriptive term for it.